Hello everyone, welcome to the first lecture in the course of Essence of Indian Traditional Knowledge. In this video lecture, I am going to discuss with you basic structure of Indian knowledge system. It is the first part in Unit 1. So these are the subtopics we have in Unit 1. The first topic is basic structure of Indian knowledge system, and the other topics mostly covers on Veda and its definition and kinds. Okay. In separate videos, I'll discuss in detail about Vedas and Upavedas and its definition and kinds. Now, in this video, I'm going to stick with only basic structure of Indian knowledge system. Now, we are going to try to understand what is the system of knowledge. With these few statements, we can understand Indian civilization has always attached great value to the knowledge. So in our civilization, a lot of importance has given to knowledge system. So we can see how that was established in our India. So India's knowledge tradition is ancient and uninterrupted, like the flow of the river Ganga from the Vedas to Sri Aurobindo. Knowledge has been at the center of all rational and speculative inquiry in India. There are three terms which are closely connected in all discussions of knowledge: Darshana, Jnana, and Vidya. So looking at these points, you can understand, in our Indian tradition, knowledge has been given a great value, and it is established or surviving from the beginning of the human race. So this knowledge can be understood, how this knowledge is going to be established. We can understand in these three terms, okay? What are the darshana, jnana, and vidya? So what is the meaning of darshana, right? Darshana means philosophy. So it is the system, the point of view, which helps or leads to jnana. So darshana means here, whatever the philosophy we are going to take to understand a particular subject. So that way of understanding or thinking is going to be called as darshana. So that philosophy gives us a systematic way of understanding or looking at some subject or studying some subject in a systematic way. So that gives a philosophy. And the process of learning or understanding or studying in a way of a method or the philosophical aspect that leads us to gain the knowledge. So that is called jnana. So when knowledge gathered through studying different source of material and observation, getting experience on a particular experiment. So that experiment, through that experiment, we get certain idea or knowledge, and that knowledge is going to be gathered about a particular domain, is organized and systematized for the purpose of, to say, reflection and pedagogy. So it is called vidya, discipline. Vidya means discipline, okay? So when knowledge gathered about a particular domain is called and systematized. So whatever the knowledge we gained through the certain kinds of experiments, that knowledge is going to be organized in a systematic way. Why we'll make that information or knowledge in a system, of way? It is to teach someone or to reflect our knowledge or to explain to someone. So this process, this saying to someone or reflection on ourself or somebody's knowledge or pedagogy, it is called vidya. So discipline. So whatever today's system of education today we have, that is somebody's philosophy and that is somebody's knowledge. And those knowledge we are going to learn through the process of discipline, okay, or this vidya. And what is the body of organized knowledge? How this knowledge is organized in a systematic way? Let us see that. So the entire body of organized knowledge is divided into two sets in the Mundakopanishad. These two sets of knowledge are Paravidya and Aparavidya. So what is the meaning of Paravidya? Paravidya is kind of knowledge, is observational and is gained by the eyes, etc. So to acquire it, only the sensory apparatus, including the mind, has to be prepared. So aparavidya means here just you are going to get the knowledge through your eyes and mind. So our sensory apparatuses only, but where you are not going to experience that problem or the situation, but you are looking at the situation and feeling through your sensory motors, and you are going to absorb the thing only. This is external knowledge we can consider. So it is a kind of external thing, but not internal thing. Okay. So what is apara vidya? Apara vidya is experimental. So this is experiential and is gained by the inner self. To acquire this kind of knowledge, the knower has to go through process of preparation, which is called a sadhana, knowledge acquisition. So here you can see apara vidya, it is internal processing, it is an internal self. So you can learn it through your own experiences. So whatever the knowledge you are going to gain through the experimental by yourself, that knowledge is called aparavidya, or it can be called a practical knowledge. Paravidya means a theoretical knowledge. So theoretical knowledge is completely different from experimental knowledge. For example, I ask you to read a text on how to swim in water. So if you read the process of swimming, you will know that. But if I throw you into the water, it is not enough for you just having knowledge of how to swim, but you must have a practical knowledge, experience of swimming. Then only you can save yourself from the water. Otherwise, you are going to drown in the water. So this theoretical knowledge, the book knowledge, is going to be considered as paravidya. But aparavidya means here you are going to learn the knowledge of swimming while you are in the water. You are struggling to overcome or to get out of the water. So that whatever the knowledge, whatever the experience you are going to get through the process of swimming in the water, that is called aparavidya. So practical knowledge. So practical knowledge means aparavidya, and theoretical knowledge is paravidya. And next, so the Jaina thought also makes a distinction between pratyaksha jnana, which is knowledge present to the self, and paroksha jnana, which is present to the senses and the mind. So indriya mana sapeksha. So paravidya and aparavidya, both are other terms which are given by the Jainis. Okay, Jaina, the people who believes in Jaina religion. So those people have given the other terms. So pratyaksha jnana and atma sapeksha. Okay, these are the other terms we have. And now we are going to know about Indian knowledge traditions. So in the first introduction lecture, I told you the difference between the Indian knowledge tradition and Indian knowledge system. So tradition means about a practice or a belief which we transform from one person to another person. It can be in the form of oral or it can be in the form of written. So that process of transmission is called tradition. So here, especially in the form of tradition of Indian knowledge. Here in the beginning, the knowledge has been transmitted from one generation to another generation in the form of oral only, because the people do not have the writing script at that time. So all the knowledge, whatever the knowledge, it can be literature, it can be science, it can be mathematical, or any medicine also, transmitted from oral form, orally only. So let me tell you. So in the tradition, knowledge has been constituted. The knowledge has been constituted, stored, and maintained in the framework of oral culture. So today, today we are constituting and storing and maintaining the framework of knowledge in the form of written culture. So we are storing all the knowledge in a particular form of book, that form. But in the beginning, in our Indian tradition, there are no written scripts. So that's why they have stored all the knowledge in the form of oral culture only. So this oral culture might be in the form of sutras, or in the form of stories, in the form of sameta. We can call different kinds of dramas, like plays, like through that form they have been transmitted, especially in the system of Guru Shishya. So a teacher who has been trained in the particular knowledge, and that knowledge is going to be trained or transmitted to the students. So you all of you know that in the ancient days, gurus or teachers teach their skills to the students in the Gurukulas. So there they do not have any prescribed textbooks like that to learn today, like we learning. Okay, they depend on completely only Guru. So Guru is the only the source of learning, and Guru is the only the textbook to the students. So students do not have any material to refer and learn the that skill. Whatever the knowledge it is, whatever the knowledge, it may be the knowledge of Bhagavad Gita, Ramayana, or it may be called literature, the knowledge of literature, or the knowledge of archery, or the knowledge of battlefield, the knowledge of science, the knowledge of medicine, technology, architecture, anything which has been transmitted in orally from Guru to Shishya only, teacher to student only. But they do not have a prescribed textbooks like today we have to learn ourselves also. Okay, now let us come to the point. Knowledge is constituted in our inner self. So at the time, the knowledge is going to be constituted in our self, inner self it is. There is the antarjnana. There is a term, it is called antarjnana. So this antarjnana means constituted by the input of the senses. Indriya, senses means indriyas, we call it is, okay. Constituted by the input of the senses and processed by the mind and the intellect. Intellect means buddhi, and finally constituted knowledge exists as our transformed alert self, chitta, we can call it is chitta, okay. So at the time, so today we are going to store the information in the form of book and other memory cards like that, but at the time, the students remember all the information whatever taught by his teacher in his mind only. So there is a process of remembering. There is a particular system of remembering information is also there. So they store all the information in the code system, in the code form. So today also we are making information to store in on system in the form of file documentation. In the same way, they might have a particular code system to remember particular category of information. So knowledge is constituted in our inner self. So there is the antarjnana. So this, with the help of this antarjnana, how this antarjnana is going to develop through the senses, which are, the senses are going to be processed by the mind, and through the this senses and mind, you are going to become an intellectual. Okay, you are going to gain a perfect knowledge on a given subject. Therefore, while both perception and inference are given primacy as epistemologies, tarka, argumentation, which is we called epistemologies means tarka, argumentation, is also accorded an important place. So in the process of gaining knowledge, this argumentation has given more important in the process of learning. Just note to remember all the information, but the students are asked to argue on a given particular topic to elaborate their knowledge and at the same time to enhance their knowledge and to remember permanently about that topic. So the Indian mind has not relied completely on mind and senses. So Indian knowledge is not given always a priority to the mind and senses. It has accorded the central role in knowledge formation to meditation and deep reflection. So this is the meditation is the best process of gaining knowledge. Especially this meditation, the act of meditation helps the students to remember the information and understand the information and store the information for a long life. So that's why whenever it is come to the point of Indian traditional knowledge, you come across many gurus in the form of or in the position of sitting by closing their eyes and crossed legs. So they goes on meditation. With the meditation, their memory power increases, their concentration, their sense organs also gets into their control. And once they got the control over their sense organs and mind, they make they instruct all the sense organs and their mind to remember the information and receive, and what to receive and what not to receive, and how to store it and for how long it to be stored. So all the information it is going to be learned. So that's why most of our Indian knowledge system depended not just on mind and senses, but it is given formation to meditation and deep reflection. Okay, so this meditation and deep reflection is called chintana and manana. And next, so Indian mind has depended more on hypothetical deductive methodology than on observational inductive methodology. So our Indian mind has depended more on hypothetical deductive methodology than on observational inductive methodology. The oral texts, they are constituted to facilitate memorization as they have to be held in the mind and transmitted orally in the Guru-Sishya mode. Right, the oral texts. Oral text means here the text which is in the form of oral only. So one person has to speak and another person has to listen. Only that is the point, okay? So they are constituted to facilitate memorization as they have to be held in the mind. So they have to store the text in their mind only, but they do not have a notebook to store it, to refer back it. But they have to listen and they have to store in the mind. But they do not have an option to copy-paste it somewhere else, okay? And they have to transmit it orally in Guru-Sishya mode only. So you learned some subject knowledge now. Today you need to present it to your listeners. But you cannot give them the information on paper like today we can give. Because today there are a lot of sources, material to learn as a particular subject. So knowledge in this mode is simultaneous, not sequential or linear. It is so the knowledge in this mode means here oral text, oral tradition. In oral tradition, knowledge is simultaneous. So not sequential or linear, as is the case in the scriptal tradition. So scriptal tradition means in written form, written tradition. Okay, so in written tradition, we might have a sequence of information, a linear information we can provide. So, for example, a book will be divided chapter-wise. So, introduction chapter and elaborative chapter, second chapter, third chapter, like that. So, the subject of introduction chapter will give introduction to all the book, and it is going to elaborate topic-wise. So that is called a sequential order you can provide in a book. But in oral form, it is not going to be always in a sequential. It is simultaneous, it is going to be learnt. There is no any particular method of organized or systematized. So the knowledge will be given based on the situation, based on the experiences, based on time and environment. It is given, every context has been taken a source of pursueness or learning. Every situation, every time, every incident has been taken as a source of learning. So that is the point. So it is important to note that oral culture is an alternative culture of knowledge. It is important to note that oral culture is an alternative culture of knowledge and not a default culture. It is not a default culture. It one that is there because writing systems are unknown, as is often alleged, because it is alternative culture. There is no option for them. So they have only the natural thing. It has to be learned through the nature directly. They do not have option to depend on someone. Like today we have, if there is no teacher, you can depend on textbook. If do not have a textbook, you can depend on somebody's help. Either it can be teacher, it can be friend, it can be family members or any other. So there are even, you can also depend on internet. There are many other sources you have to learn the subject knowledge. But of the time, they do have only the source of teacher to gain the knowledge. Okay, that is the point. So in the oral culture of knowledge, the scholar has a library in his mind. What he is saying, the scholar has a library in his mind and the speed of information processing is very high. The speed of information processing is very high, much higher than in the scriptural mode where the information is first transformed to the mind through senses. See, this is the remember, today we have physical libraries, digital libraries to get the information in the form of books or journals or e-books in the form of videos, in the form of audios. There are many other sources we have. But in ancient India, in the oral culture of knowledge in India, we have only library in the form of a mind only. The scholar's mind is the library. So he has to store everything as a segment, different segments in his mind. But he do not have any option to store somewhere else, because they have knowledge in the form of oral only. He listens from somebody and he delivers it to someone. This is only the process they have. Okay, so that's why library is built in his mind only. And the speed of information processing is very high. Because if you would like to search for some information on internet, you have to type it. You have to search it. You have to identify the suitable information. But if you have all the knowledge already in your mind, so that mind immediately gives answer to a particular question. So that's why you can imagine how the brain works when you have a knowledge on a particular subject. If you were asked to respond on a particular given topic, you immediately responds because you have knowledge on that. So the mind gives an immediate response if you have knowledge stored in this mind. So the library of ancient oral culture is mind only. So the speed of information processing is very high, much higher than in the scriptural mode. Scriptural mode means written mode it is, where the information is first transferred to the mind through the senses. Through the senses, they are going to store in the mind. Okay. Now today, up to now, we have discussed about international knowledge or Indian knowledge tradition. And now we are going to know Indian knowledge system. So this Indian knowledge system is nothing but the knowledge which is in the form of oral culture, which is going to be brought into the systematized in the form of scriptural form. So that is called Indian knowledge system. So the texts of knowledge have been constituted, maintained and transmitted in the oral framework of Indian history of ideas. Okay. And knowledge of different domains over a period of time has been institutionalized as so many disciplines, vidya, crafts, kala. So Indian disciplinary formations include fields as diverse as philosophy, architecture, grammar, mathematics, astronomy, metrics, sociology, economy and polity, ethics, geography, logic, military sciences, weaponry, agriculture, mining, trade, commerce, metallurgy, mining, shipbuilding, medicine, poetics, biology and veterinary science. In each of these, a continuous and cumulative series of texts continues to be available in spite of widespread loss and historically recorded destruction. So the tradition talks of 18 major vidyas, theoretical disciplines, and 64 kalas, applied or vocational disciplines, craft. So here we have 18 major vidyas we have. So 18 major disciplines, subject knowledge they have, and 64 kalas. So kalas means here arts. Okay, 64 kalalu ani antam kada. So those aspects we have in art, in Indian knowledge tradition. So what are they? The 18 vidyas are the four Vedas, the four subsidiary Vedas: Ayurveda, medicine, Dhanurveda, weaponry, Gandharva Veda, music and Shilpa, architecture; Purana, Nyaya, Mimasa and Dharmasastra and Vedanga. The six auxiliary sciences: phonetics, grammar, meter, astronomy, ritual and philosophy. These constitute 18 sciences in ancient India. So these crafts have a direct bearing on day-to-day life of the people, and most of them are still part of the Indian life. Yes. So this Indian traditional knowledge is directly connected with the day-to-day life of this people in the society. And all these subjects are relevant to the day-to-day needs of human beings, and they are associated with the life of people in the present also. So that is the relevance. That is why it is very important to have the knowledge of our tradition knowledge. Okay. Thank you all. We will meet in the next lecture.